Oh, already in. Bismillah, bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa lah, amma ba'd. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. So today, inshallah ta'ala, what we'll be covering is a heavy topic. It's evidence for the soul. And the reason why I want to cover this is because I'm guessing that a lot of you guys in high school and so forth are dealing with people who don't believe in the soul. And therefore, you would say, I believe in it. And they would say, why? What evidence do you have? And you feel maybe embarrassed or shy, like you're stuck and you don't have anything to say. And so I want to make sure you guys are equipped. Now, I'm going to have to warn you that this can get pretty philosophical and pretty abstract. So you're going to have to try to pay attention. And like I said, inshallah ta'ala, reserve your comments and questions for the end. So the first question is, did matter produce consciousness, or did a consciousness produce matter? That's the first question. I know it's a little bit abstract in nature. What I'm saying is basically, is it the case that in the beginning, from the atheist perspective, in the beginning there was matter, and it formed into complex beings from which emerged minds? Or is it the case from the theistic perspective, from the religious perspective, that in the beginning there was a will, or a mind, or a consciousness, al-alim, al-khabir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this will, this consciousness, willed matter and beings into existence, and by doing what? By saying be and it is, kun fayakun. So obviously the second one is the Islamic perspective, right? And now the question is, how do we answer this? Which one is it? Did matter create mind, or did mind create matter? This is an age-old question. And I think one way to answer it that is pretty straightforward is, well, which one is more immediate to you as an individual? Which one do you experience primarily, first? Which one is more fundamental to your life experience? And now I think most of you would probably say to yourselves, well, obviously matter. I feel like matter is more primary. Why? Because, I mean, look at everything around me. I got this desk in front of me, I could see. When I look at you people, I don't see your soul. I don't see your mind or your personality. What I see is your physical body. I see the roof and the walls and everything. So obviously matter seems primary to me. However, my response to that would be, let's not forget that all of that is being filtered through your mind. I don't know if any of you guys saw that movie, The Matrix. It's pretty old. You guys are quite young. But anyway, it's a famous film. And the whole idea is what? That everything that you see and hear and taste and smell and touch is being filtered through your consciousness. And technically, it can be altered. And this actually goes back. And what that implies is that the mind is actually primary. Consciousness is actually primary. And that matter is secondary. And I think René Descartes, the famous French philosopher, he said it best when he said, I think, therefore I am. It's a famous quote. I'm sure you guys have heard it before. Let me explain it a little bit for those of you that don't understand what that means. Cogito ergo sum, it implies what? That I can doubt everything. I can doubt everything. I can doubt that this is a table in front of me. I can doubt my own hands. I can doubt that any of you people are here. I can doubt everything that I think is true. I can doubt everything. But you know what I can't doubt? There's only one thing I can't doubt, and that is that I'm thinking. Because the more I doubt it, what am I doing? I'm thinking. That's the only thing I can't doubt. The more and more I keep trying to doubt that I exist and that there's a me and that there's this thing that is thinking, the more I doubt it, the more I affirm it. So that was sort of his big revelation, if you will. And from that, he said that the one thing that I know is that I think and therefore I am. Hence the expression, I think, therefore I am. So, and what he was trying to express is that everything else can be doubted. So even, let's say, the material world or my physical body can be doubted, but my very consciousness or my soul or myself or whatever term you want to give it, that cannot be doubted. And from that, he discerned and he differentiated and said, therefore, there must be two things. There must be this, the difference between my mind and my body, because obviously one I can't doubt and one I can. So clearly, this is sort of, you could say, the beginning, the preliminary justifications for this idea that there's more than us than just our bodies. There's more to it than that. Now, what is the soul? We need a definition, right? The soul is an immaterial thing that gives us consciousness, identity, and free will. Now, I'm not going to be talking about identity and free will today. I'm just going to be talking about consciousness only, inshallah ta'ala. The fact that you are conscious. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell us about this ruh, this soul? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, listen, you're not going to fully comprehend it. You'll never get to that point. Why? Allah says what? وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ. They ask you about the soul. Tell them the soul is from the affair of my Lord, and mankind hasn't been given of knowledge except a little bit. In other words, this is something that you're never going to fully get. So does that mean we should just give up? No. We can try to figure out as much as we can, inshallah ta'ala. Now, why not just attribute consciousness to the brain? That's what most atheists would say. They'd say, listen, it's not that I have a body, it's that I am a body. That's the atheistic perspective. The believer's perspective is that I have a body. There's this me, this ghost in the machine, if you will, that is me. And this ghost, this soul, this ruh, it can operate this machinery, the body. Whereas the atheist would say, no, it's not that you have a body, it's that you are a body. There's nothing but the physical body itself. And they would say the proof of that is the fact that some people receive brain damage, right? It happens. People receive brain damage, and from that, their personalities become altered. So then the question is, if your personality is altered due to brain damage, has your soul been altered? And so the atheist kind of puts the believer in a tough spot, and you're like, oh, how do I answer this? And I think the easiest answer is that, well, the soul operates the body kind of the same way a musician operates an instrument. And what I mean by that is, if you damage the instrument, then the music won't play the same. But that doesn't mean that you have eliminated the musician or deleted his skills. You get my point? The musician is still there. He's still perfectly skillful. The issue is just that you've damaged his tool, and therefore the production or the product that he's going to make is going to be much different and much, let's say, worse. So that's one way out of this issue. Now, why is it that we believe that consciousness is not just from the brain itself, not just from physical matter? So I'm going to offer several different points. You could say mental exercises, things that you can think about to see how there's a difference between the physical matter of your brain and your actual consciousness. So the first one is called Leibniz's Law of Identity. And basically he said that a thing is identical to itself. Seems like the most obvious thing in the world, right? A thing is identical to itself, or mathematically speaking, X equals X. Doesn't seem so complicated. However, it's an interesting formula when you start to apply it to different things. What do I mean? So let me give a simple example to show you what I mean. Water is H2O in every way. Water is H2O. It's the same thing. It's kind of like saying, you know, X equals X. It's just one thing. And what that implies is that water has the same boiling point as H2O. It has the same freezing point. It has the same density. It has every single property the same because they're the same thing. Now the question is, if the materialist says, you are your brain, there's no difference between you and your brain. That's it. That's all there is. There's reasons to doubt that. There's reasons to think that such a position is actually doubtable. What are they? Number one, you can observe brain states. You can observe a brain and all the different electrical, impulses that are going on while a person is feeling happy or sad or feeling excited or feeling depressed or whatever. And you could see the different activity in their brain. But does that mean that you understand what it feels for that person to be sad or to be happy or to be depressed or to be excited? Are you able to observe the brain's activity and understand what they're feeling? And the answer is no. The only way we understand what they're feeling is by our own recognizing our own feelings of happiness and sadness and trying to relate to that person. So from that, you already start to see that, well, maybe there's something more than just these electrical impulses. Maybe there's something, it's called a qualia. If you've never heard this term before, a qualia is defined as the subjective component of experiencing something. Like right now, I feel this table, that's the qualia. And you guys, you could study my brain and see what goes off and what is reacting and so on and so forth when I feel this, but just because you're observing that doesn't mean you know what it feels like for me to touch this. You don't understand the actual subjective experience of it. That's a very important point. So clearly, already you're starting to see that there's a difference between just what's happening in the brain and what is being experienced. There is a qualitative difference. So it's hard to say that they're exactly the same thing. There's something more there. Another example is you could study the molecular structure of sugar all you want, but you're never going to figure out what it tastes like to taste something sweet, right? It's a different thing altogether. And perhaps the most common example that I found in different books and in different debates and so on and so forth when I was researching this topic is this example. They say, what was her name? The example of the scientist, the colorblind scientist Mary. They say, imagine this woman, her name is Mary, and she's a colorblind scientist. And imagine for a second that she knows all there is to know, both physically and functionally, about light. She studies light, and she understands the physics behind its wavelength and its speed, and the functions of the eye, and the brain's visual cortex. She understands exactly how light works and how it is received by human beings, and she studies the brain in depth, so she knows all the physics and all the chemistry behind it. Good. Now imagine that one day, after all of her extensive research and knowledge, her color blindness gets cured. She goes through some sort of operation, and boom, she's cured. She goes outside, and she sees a beautiful garden with all these amazing, wonderful, very vibrant colors. The question is, upon seeing this these colors, would such a person learn something new? What do you guys think, yes or no? Yes, okay, so this is just a thought experiment to say that yes, of course, she didn't learn something new about the physical facts, but the mental facts. And from that, you distinguish between the physical facts and the mental facts, that there is something different about these two categories of knowledge. So already we're starting to understand this idea that you are your brain, there's nothing difference between you and your brain. Well, not really, there's a qualitative difference. So that's part one. Secondly, a person could say, yeah, but all of that is just being experienced by the brain itself. Now, the problem with this is that what is the brain made of? You could say a bunch of molecules, a bunch of atoms, right? I mean, it, the same stuff that's in our heads is the same stuff. I mean, it's carbon, H2O, the same stuff you'd find anywhere, right? It's not like it's special material you only find in the brain, right? So, wait a second. How is it that the matter in my brain can be about something else? So let's try to break it down. Let's try to go to the smallest unit. Let's go to a single atom. Is one atom conscious or self-aware? Does an atom feel anything? Does it have any thoughts? Can it be about something else? I think everybody would agree that we have no reason to believe that an atom has any thoughts, feelings, or what it's like to be an atom, or what it's like to feel or think about something else. It doesn't have any consciousness whatsoever. So then the question is, okay, what if I add a second atom? Does that change anything? What about a third, and a fourth, and a fifth, and I keep going? What if I arrange them in a really complex way? At the end of the day, the answer is it'll do nothing. It won't change anything. It's kind of like a person, I heard one example I thought was pretty clever. It's similar to a person with a big pile of red bricks. And they say, I have to build a house, but I want to build a blue house. It doesn't matter how many more red bricks you add, and it doesn't matter in which way you arrange those bricks. At the end of the day, you're not going to get any blue. It's just simply a category fallacy. Doesn't matter how you add to it, doesn't matter how you arrange it, it's a category fallacy. It doesn't work. You're working in the wrong direction. It's like, maybe if I add 100 more, it's not going to do anything. So in the same way, if you have this atom and it's not conscious, and then you add a second and a third, and you rearrange it, and you try to twist it, and you try to make it more complex, and it doesn't matter what you do with it. All of them, it's 0 + 0 + 0. Doesn't matter how many times you add 0, what do you get? You get 0. So they are unconscious. They are just matter. And so no matter how many times you add them up and make them really complex, even in the configuration of our brains, it seems that there's no reason for that piece of fatty tissue in our heads to actually experience anything. It's perfectly fine to say that it's like a computer, but computers don't experience anything. And I'll give an example that hopefully you guys can all relate to. All of you guys have your phones, right? And what you can do with your phone is you can hit record and record a video. We all know this, right? And we know that information is being recorded through the eye, you know, the camera, and also through the ears, or microphone. And all that information is going into the memory of the phone when you record as a bunch of ones and zeros, right? We all know this, the binary, right? It just gets recorded as binary ones and zeros. And now some people, they hypothesize and say, who knows, maybe one day we'll make a machine that is so complex, it'll be so complex to actually subjectively experience what it sees and hears. A conscious machine, basically AI. I'm sure we've all seen movies or heard about people talking about AI. One day machines will be conscious, right? Because they will take all this information and somehow learn to synthesize it into a subjective, unified stream of consciousness, right? But there's a problem. What is the problem with this issue? The problem is that what you're trying to do is you're trying to take a bunch of distinct and separate ones and zeros and unify them into one subjective stream of consciousness. And the problem is that whatever contraption you use, whatever complex machine you use to do that job is itself complex and is itself made up of different parts and components. And each of those components have nothing to do with one another. just like the ones and zeros. And therefore, what you're doing is, what you really need is a unifier for the unifier. And then you'll need a unifier for the unifier for the unifier. You guys get my point? See how this, it doesn't work. The problem isn't complexity. The problem is actually simplicity. And here's another example of this. Maybe a crude example, if you will. Maybe not the best example, but still, I still think it's kind of funny. We all know that a book might have lots of words written in it, and maybe those words produce a beautiful story, a very thought-provoking story, let's say. Does the book experience any of that meaning? The answer is obviously no. Why? Because to the book, it's just a piece of paper with a bunch of blotches of ink. There's nothing that the paper has the ability to unify those blotches of ink into words, words into sentences, sentences into paragraphs, and then therefore appreciate the meaning of what is on its pages. We all understand this. So imagine if somebody said, you know what the problem is? The book isn't complex enough. Let's add more pages. Let's add a couple more chapters. Maybe if we keep on adding, then eventually the book will appreciate how smart of a text this is. And I think everybody realizes, bro, you're going in the wrong direction. It's not more complexity that you need. It's more simplicity. And so this is why, well, Adam, but it seems that the best evidence points to that there is this fundamental property that exists in the universe, similar to the way you have matter, similar to the way you have energy. You have this thing, I don't know, I'll say this substance, and I use that word substance very loosely, that is simply consciousness. It is the soul. It is something that can take the diversity of your complex experience, because right now, as I'm talking to you, all this information is going through your eyes, going through your ears. You're recording things. You're remembering different memories from your past. Maybe some of you are thinking about what you had for lunch today. Maybe thinking about what happened a few months ago. The point is that if we were to look inside your brain, there would be neurons firing all over the place. What is unifying all that into a subjective experience? Right? What is putting that all together? Again, if you say, well, there's one part of the brain that's so complex it can pull it all together. Isn't that part of the brain also made up of parts? What is unifying the unifier? And then so you have this infinite regress of this problem. And so the problem isn't complexity. The problem is it has to be more simplified. That's what it seems to be. Wallah Adam. And so what we believe is that the soul is not an aggregate. Maybe that's a new word for you guys. An aggregate is something that is made up of parts. It is not some sort of a complex contraption. It is غير مركب. It is not made of parts. It is something basic and simple. It is something that, as we believe, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala endowed us with. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, إِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي خَالِقٌ بَشَرًا مِّن طِينٍ. Allah said, remember when your Lord said to the angels, indeed, I'm going to create a human being from clay. So that is our physical aspect of our body. That which is made from the earth. And then Allah says, فَإِذَا سَوَّيْتُهُ وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي فَقَعُوا لَهُ سَاجِدِينَ. So when I have proportioned him and then breathed into him my ruh. When I've breathed into him my ruh, then he becomes a man. So what is this describing? The two components of the human being. One which is, let's say, worldly, the other which is divine, if you want to put it in those terms. One which is made of the earth, the dirt, and then a second portion, which is this ruh, which is something that is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we can't fully comprehend, but gives us subjective experience. And what I find so fascinating, and I hope you guys can appreciate this, is that the job of this ruh, I mean, specifically with regards to consciousness, it's to unify your experience. Now, what is the word unify in Arabic? To make something one, to unify something. Anybody know what the word is? Yeah. Ah, mashallah, tabarakallah, you got it. Good for you. Mashallah, tabarakallah. I was not expecting anybody to get it. Good for you. Congratulations. Takbir. Mashallah, that was great. Wahada yuwahidu tawheed. Tawheed means to do what? To make one, right? And so it's so fascinating that we have all this sensory data that would otherwise just be this sea of information that really we have no way of unifying into a subjective consciousness. And yet, wallah alam, but it seems that Allah has endowed us with this ruh, with a soul, and that soul unifies it, which is to do wahada yuwahidu tawheed, which is to do tawheed, which is to unify this entire experience. And so, I find that amazing. I find that fascinating. It's basically saying that Allah gifted us with a soul that unifies our experience and which points us to Him. And the more that we increase our spirituality, or the more that we increase our consciousness, or maybe you guys like to use the term being more woke. I don't know. Maybe that's the term that you guys use. But the point that I'm getting at is that the more you increase in this consciousness or spirituality, the more you increase in your, or you should increase in your, tawheed. I'm sure we've all heard people, whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim, saying things like, when I pray more and when I meditate more, what does it do to me? I feel that I'm at one with everything. You guys, I've heard this type of language, that meditation and contemplation and reflection causes what? Increase in feeling of oneness with everything around you. So it seems very much that we have this soul, and it's just amazing. I mean, everybody can do this. Anybody can, it feels like there's something inside of you, this me, right? This subjective me, that can access different parts of my brain. Like, oh, I can remember what happened a few weeks ago. I can remember that time we went to this, I don't know, water park. I can remember the time that, oh, when this happened at school. It's like there's all this data in your mind, and you, this you, can just sort of go where it wants to go and extract all that information and unify all that data, let's say, whether it be what you saw and what you heard and what you felt and et cetera, et cetera. And we know that there's different parts of the brain that are operate the visual cortex, let's say, or, you know, that operate your hearing, your seeing, your touch, your feelings. It's all different parts. So there's this thing that's sort of just going around and deciding to go into your memory and bring it all together and unify it. So this, subhanAllah, I think lends credence to the idea that there is indeed a soul, and that yes, it does this, its function is essentially tawheed, which is really a fascinating concept. It's to unify your subjective experience. Now, I want to finish with two points. The first point is about a very particular verse of Quran, but before I talk about this verse of Quran, I want to do an experiment with you guys. There is a sentence with, I mean, the same words, but if you put the punctuation differently, they give you two different meanings. Let me give you an example. Woman, without her, man is nothing. And then, woman, without her man, is nothing. You guys see the difference? Did you guys catch that? Maybe I went too quickly. The idea is that the words are the exact same. One of them is saying women are extremely dependent upon men, and the other one is saying that men are extremely dependent upon women. Everybody understands that? And I made the switch just by punctuation, just by making a pause in the different place. This is a famous classic example of how punctuation is really important because it could change the whole meaning. Now, I would submit that both sentences are true in the sense that men and women are codependent. Simple as that. So in that exact same way, the reason I give this example is because there's a verse of Quran that can be understood in two different ways based on your punctuation. And I think both are true. It is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before He put us in, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created all of the souls, right? And then once this we were in this place called the Alam al-Arwah, this area, Allah Alam where it was, where it is, but it is the world of the souls. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked us, Alastu bi rabbikum? Allah asked, am I not your Lord? And then the answer is, qalu bala shahidna, that we responded, yes, we witness, yes, we testify, yes, we bear witness to that fact. And so this is something that is recorded in Surah A'raf, verse 172. And the idea here is that all of our souls, before we were put into our bodies, had this imprint, if you will, this natural inclination towards tawheed and recognition of God. Okay, that's the belief, that this event took place so that when we were born, we would have a natural inclination to believe in God and to seek Him out, etc., etc. Okay, that's a whole other conversation. But the reason I bring it up is because if you take this sentence and put the pause in a different place, it gives a different meaning. Allah asks, Alastu bi rabbikum? Allah asks each of our souls, am I not your Lord? If you say, qalu bala shahidna, then the answer is, yes, of course, as in, yes, of course you are our Lord. And then you could say in brackets, why? Because we witness. Bala shahidna, yes, of course you are our Lord. Why? Because we have consciousness. Because we have subjective experience. Subjective experience is sufficient for me to know that there must be a divine will, a divine consciousness, the ultimate creator and God. And so I think, wallahu ta'ala a'lam, that this ayah is very beautiful and very just fantastic because it's demonstrating, if you understand, if you take it from this perspective, it is stating that consciousness in and of itself is evidence that there is something about you that is beyond the physical and should make you therefore wonder, what is it about me that can witness this world? Why is it that I'm conscious? Why is it that I have, we can talk about free will and identity and so forth another time, inshallah, but why does consciousness exist? And is it sufficient? And according to this ayah, if you take it from this perspective, then yes, we said, Ya Allah, of course you are our Lord. Of course we recognize that there is a divine creator, an ultimate consciousness, an ultimate will, Al-Qadir, Al-Alim, Al-Raqib, however you want to, whatever Asma'ullah you want to use. Why? because we have this ability to witness, and that is sufficient to indicate to us that there is something beyond the physical world within us. There is something divine, if you will. So I hope that is something that piques your curiosity. The last thing that I want to mention, inshallah ta'ala, before we'll open up for comments and questions, the last point that I want to make is that if anybody wants to research this topic more, first of all, you could study this for your whole life and never reach the bottom. There's so many books on this topic about consciousness and free will and the brain, and it just, it goes on and on and on. There's many debates online. I watched several videos about this, debates, etc. However, one subject that I did not touch, I just want to let you guys know that there is another subject with regards to this topic, and that is called NDE, or near-death experiences. And essentially, there have been people who have, you could say, cataloged or documented all the different cases, not all, but like many cases, of people who, on their, let's say, operating table, experienced floating above their bodies, experienced watching their bodies being operated on. And, you know, the doctors were like, look, we could see that there was no brain activity. You weren't recording anything. You weren't thinking anything. We had you hooked up. We could see that you were essentially brain dead. And yet somehow they're like, no, I remember everything. I know exactly what operations you did. I know what you guys were talking about. And furthermore, sometimes people describe accurately what other conversations were happening in a different room. So let's say their family members and friends were outside in the hallway and they were talking about this and that and the other. They come back to consciousness and they say, why are you guys saying this and that about me? You know, preparing my funeral and so forth. And people are like, how did you know that? It's like, because I was there. I was sort of floating around. So the thing is, now it's possible that you could say, well, maybe people are exaggerating, or maybe people are straight up lying. But the thing is, when you actually do research into this and look at how many reports there are of this, recorded by, you know, accurate or reliable sources, at a certain point you start to wonder, well, maybe I shouldn't be so skeptical, maybe there is something behind this. And just keep in mind that even if 99% of them, or let's say almost all of them are lies, if one of them is true, that's enough for the materialist to question his position. So, inshallah ta'ala, with that I close. And where's that brother Nasir? Is he there? You think you can? Jazakallah khair. So with that I close, inshallah ta'ala. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who keep on working on our souls. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen.